In the presence of the Lord.
Quickly, let's go to Genesis chapter 1, if you will. I was in the back, and the Lord just started showing me stuff. And make sure your cell phone on tonight, because I might call some of y'all. I'm serious. I was in the back, and I told them, I said, y'all have just seen a number come before me. And so just keep your phone on, but, you know, keep it on vibrate. I might call you and tell you what the Lord told me to tell you. All right, now look at somebody and say, God is up to something. I want you to hear me, and I want you to hear me good tonight, because as I told you, that if a man is truly a prophet, if he really carries that mantle upon his life and he's really a prophet, and you got to remember something now, just because you have the gift of prophecy don't mean you're a prophet. Just because you prophesy don't mean you're a prophet. There were three different realms of the prophetic. You have the spirit of prophecy, you have the gift of prophecy, and you have the office of the prophet. Okay, the gift of prophecy is a gift that you're born with. Remember, Paul told Timothy, stir up the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by the laying on of hands. But if you pay attention, you notice that that gift was not only in him, it was also in his mother. Y'all remember, right? Yeah, I believe he had a mother named Eunice and a grandmother named Lois. So that gift came down the bloodline. Say amen. Amen. So you have the gift of prophecy, but then you have the spirit of prophecy. But because there's a prophetic anointing on my life and I'm ministering here tonight, the power of God can begin to move in the service and the atmosphere can become conducive for anything to take place. And the spirit of prophecy will come in the room and you will begin to prophesy just like King Saul prophesied when he got around the prophetic. But just because you prophesy don't mean you're a prophet. The office of the prophet is totally different. Now remember, Ephesians 4:11 declares he gave some apostles. You did hear some, right? So that means everybody saying they one can't be one. Y'all quiet. Y'all mad at me. What's wrong? I'm trying to help you tonight. Okay. He gave some. Somebody shout some. All right, now the apostle of the church is the thumb of the church. You understand? The thumb can operate, or your thumb is your only finger that can touch every finger on your hand. So the apostle is the governor of the church. He brings order, he brings structure, he brings foundation. An apostle is a builder. He can't stay in one place. The apostle, the prophet, and the evangelist are traveling gifts, but the pastor and the teacher are stationary gifts. If a man is an apostle, he dances to the beat of a different drum. He's different. He's not like everybody else. I'm very disappointed with people who are calling themselves apostles now, but they have no power. They have no deliverance. The Bible declares that I have tried them who say that they are apostles and have found them to be liars. If you are an apostle, you have to operate in the apostolic anointing. You have to preach what the apostles preach, and your testimony have to be that you have seen the Lord. Y'all quiet in here. If you've not had a visitation from the Lord Jesus Christ, you cannot be an apostle. We see every apostle in the Bible who walk with Jesus, talk with Jesus, except for one named Paul. The Bible declares he was born out of due season. He didn't have the opportunity to walk with Jesus like the other apostles, but on the road to Damascus, a light shined out of heaven and said, Saul, Saul, why are y'all with me here? So he gave some apostles. Somebody shout, some. Okay, but then he gave some prophets. Now, the prophet is the index finger of the church. He comes to point to you, get in your face, tell you that God ain't gonna give you a new house until you stop shacking in the house you got. You're quiet, yeah. That's what the prophet comes to. Why y'all ain't shout no more? What's wrong with you? Yeah, the prophet comes to tell you, like Isaiah went to Hezekiah and said, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live. I am very disappointed with these jellyback prophets who've had an opportunity to talk to the president, and they get in the White House and get up there and compromise because they want doors open. I told somebody the other day, they came to me the other day, and they say, Prophet Carn, if you keep on preaching like that, they're going to close their doors on you. I got discouraged for about 3 seconds, and then I heard the Holy Ghost say, I am the door. Y'all ain't talking back to me here. I don't care what door you close. If God open it, you can't close it. Y'all ain't talking back to me. You can shut the door of your church, and I'll set up a tent next door. I'm ready for a good old revival meeting. Somebody say hallelujah. I'm very disappointed. Y'all sit down with prophets who've had the opportunity to stand and talk to presidents, and they get there and compromise, all because they want to be somebody. They want to be recognized. They want to be seen. You got to understand that if a man is going to be a prophet, he has to be willing to be different. He can't be concerned about people liking him, fitting in a circle. As a matter of fact, if you're a prophet, you don't hang with everybody. You got to walk by yourself. You're going to be misunderstood. You're going to be despised and rejected. Don't nobody want to hear you when you telling them to come out of their sin and come out of their mess. God is mad with America. You sitting up here telling some God is going to bless a nation when he said if a man lay with another man, it's an abomination. And we trying to make right what God said is wrong. The Bible declares that judgment shall begin in the house of the Lord. But we got too many preachers who won't preach on homosexuality because it's in the praise team, because it's in the choir. But God's getting ready to raise up some real prophets who gonna call it like it is, that'll cry loud and a spare not. I need somebody to jump on your feet and shout glory. Be seated. He gave some apostles, some prophets. God has nothing to say to America but 2 Chronicles 7:14. That's all he's saying. If my people, yeah. That's all God is saying. That's what God is saying to this backslidden church. That's what God is saying to this church that got money but don't have no power. To this church that drive nice cars but no power, no deliverance. If you had as much power as you had money, think about how many people would be healed. Think about how many folk could be set free. God's calling this church back to a place of repentance. If my people, he wasn't talking to the drug dealer, he wasn't talking to the prostitute, but he was talking to the apostle, he was talking to the prophet, he was talking to the evangelist. He said, my people, which are called by my name, you got to humble yourself. Look at you arrogant preachers. You're arrogant, you're proud as a peacock. Can't nobody tell you nothing. God's getting ready to break these preachers. He gonna bring you back to your knees. God said, I hate arrogance. God's getting ready to humble you. That's why I'm telling God, whatever's in my life that ain't right, get it out of me. I don't want to preach to others and be a castaway. I don't want to come to church and die and go to hell. I want to be holy. I want to be right. Jump on your feet and shout hallelujah. You gotta humble yourself. Look at somebody shout, humble yourself. Why y'all ain't shouting? Come on. Look at somebody say, humble yourself. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. That old spirit of pride. It's a sneaky spirit. It's a conniving spirit. Pride. Proverbs 6:16 declares, 6 things doth the Lord hate. 7 are an abomination. He said he hates a proud look that just killed 75% of all preachers. You come to church and look proud. You don't shout till you got the mic. You don't praise God till you got the mic. I'm sick of you preachers that don't praise God unless you got the mic. When is the last time your church seen you dance? When is the last time your church seen you praise God? This old spirit of arrogance that is creeping across the body of Christ. He hates a proud look. God spoke to me one day. He said, son, pride is like a stealth jet. I say, what do you mean? He said, it's like a stealth jet. Well, I'm a church boy. I don't know what no stealth jet is. It's a military term. It's a warfare term. That if they're getting ready to come in, if they go stealth, that means it can't be detected by the radar. That's what pride does. It sneaks in your life, and you don't even recognize it's there. Pride is that spirit that got you where can't nobody tell you nothing. Pride is that spirit that got you where you can't submit to authority. Pride is that spirit where you sitting up here getting mad. Who we talking to? I'm talking to you with your proud self. Pride is that spirit that got you when somebody tell you something, you catching an attitude. Ain't no need in getting an attitude. If you're a real child of God, you don't get mad when you hear a word like this. You go to searching your heart. You're going to say, God, get pride out of me. Get this mess out of me. There was a man in the Bible by the name of Lucifer. You remember him. God told me, he said, pride is the only spirit that can stand in my presence. We saw it happen in Lucifer. He stood right there in the presence of God. Pride will let you preach. Pride will let you prophesy. Pride will let you sing on the praise team. Pride will let you sing in the choir. That's what pride will do. And some of you don't recognize that pride is that spirit that got you that you can't even get up. You won't even pray. You don't even seek God. You don't call on him. You want to know why? Because you think you don't need God. Some of you in here, when is the last time you got on your face and got on the altar and told God to make you over again? Pride is that spirit that won't let you pray. But there's about 500 people in here today that are saying, man of God, I hear God, and whatever's in me that ain't like God, I gotta get it out of me tonight. Cause God resists the proud, but he give grace to the humble. Shake three people and say, humble yourself, humble yourself, humble yourself. This ain't my message. Sit down. My people, call by my name. Slap somebody, say, humble yourself. You ain't say that with power, but come on, say, humble yourself. Humble yourself. That's what God is saying to America. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. Proverbs 8:13 say, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogance. Humble yourself. Preachers, humble yourself. Huh? Act like you can't open the door for yourself. Why y'all ain't shout no more? Humble yourself. Then he said, when you get a little humble in yourself, I need you to get a prayer life. The sad thing about church, we're so good at doing church. And most of us in here today, you don't have to tell me, I just know. Most of us in here tonight didn't pray for 1 hour. And he said to the disciples, could not you wait with me but for 1 hour? But we sit home and watch TV. Y'all quiet. We stay on social media, Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, and the enemy is slowly pulling us away from the presence of God. Lord said to me one time, he said, son, the enemy is doing the church. You may have heard me say it before, like an amphibian. I said, Lord, what in the world is that? You know, a frog is an amphibian. It can adjust to any temperature. I said, okay, what that mean? He said, if you want to cook a frog, if you put him in hot boiling water, he'll jump out. But if you put him in the water cold and slowly turn up the heat, because he can adjust to the temperature, he's being cooked and he don't know it. I said, well, what that got to do with us? He said, that's what the devil did to you. Things that used to bother you don't bother you no more. When you first got saved, if it was too much cussing, you turn it off. Oh, y'all quiet in here, yeah. You turn on the TV, they were cussing too much, you turn it off. If it was too much flesh, you turn it off. If you was in a room with people that were sitting up gossiping and backbiting, you get up out of the room. But now, you sit in there, talk with them, watch anything on television, they use profanity and curse, it don't bother you no more, because slowly, you're becoming numb to what you used to hate. It's because you've lost your prayer life. You've lost your dedication. I heard a preacher on television just the other day. He said he was preaching this grace message. You know, they preaching this big grace message now. And I ain't trying to bother nobody. Do whatever you believe Lord told you to do. But he was preaching this grace message. And he got on television. And he said, you ain't got to pray no more. He said, Jesus prayed for you. I said, the devil is a liar. Luke 18 declares, men ought always to pray and to faint not. 1 Thessalonians 5 declares, pray without ceasing. He didn't say if you pray, he said, but when you pray. You know what's wrong with us? You want to know why you got mess in your life? Because you don't pray. He said, pray lest you enter into temptation. I can tell people who spend time with God, I can tell in your life, I can tell the way you live, because when you spend time with him and you have fellowship with him and you commune with him, your desire is to always do those things that please the Father. But some of you in here today, you don't pray, you don't fast. God spoke to me the other day. He said, son, if Jesus had to pray, who was perfect, who did no sin, who never did no evil, if he had to pray, how much more you got to pray? You want to know why I pray? I was talking to somebody and they say, you act like you holy, you praying all time like you holy. I said, I'm not praying because I'm holy, I'm praying because I got stuff in my life that I need God to break up off of me. I'm praying because I got demons on my back. I'm praying because there's a war going on in my members. When I would do good, evil is always present. I'm praying because I got mess in my life, that if I don't pray, I got demons from my daddy and demons from my grandfather, generational curses that the devil wants to bring upon my life. But if I pray, I can beat the devil. I got to pray. Shake your neighbor and say, I gotta pray. Shake somebody real hard. Come on, shake them real. Come on, don't play with it. Shake them. Shake them. I don't care if they get mad at you. Shake them anyway and tell them it's praying time. It's praying time. It's time to turn off the TV. It's time to turn off your phone. And it's time to seek God like you never saw him before. Missouri ain't seen nothing. New York City ain't seen nothing. I don't care what nobody say. It's the wrath of God coming upon the children of disobedience. But if my people, which are called by my name, humble yourself, pray, seek my face, and turn from your wicked ways, I need you to run to three people and tell them it's praying time. for you to pray. You got to pray. Because the devil is after your children. You got to pray. Because there are demons after your family. You got to pray. Because there's spirits that's been assigned to your house. And unless you pray, you can't keep the devil back. You got to pray. Because there are demons assigned to your ministry. Let me tell you something. If you can't find nothing else to pray for, every morning I wake up, I rebuke the wandering of my mind. I pray that my mind don't leave me. Come on, don't act like your mind don't walk away from you. You can run down the street and forget where you're going. You can pick up the phone and forget who you're about to call. But Isaiah 26 said, I'll keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stayed on me. I've not given you a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. I got to pray. I got to pray so that I don't enter into temptation. I got to pray because there's a war going on in my members. I got to seek the face of God because I told God the only way I'm going to be like you is I got to spend time with you. I got to have fellowship. I got to have communion. Some of you in here, you wonder why you backbiting and bitter. You wonder why. You want to know why? Because you don't pray. He said, pray lest you enter into temptation. See, prayer is intimacy with God. But there's a law in the spirit that if you don't talk to God, you automatically begin to talk to the devil. So the reason you bitter, and the reason you backbiter, and the reason you full of malice is because you've been talking to the devil. And that's what the devil is. But God's getting ready to raise up a people that are saying, listen here, I'll cut off whoever I got to cut off. I'll let go whoever I got to let go. But the next time you see me, I'm about to walk in a realm with God I never walked in. I'm about to get so full of power that when I walk in a room, my shadow is going to cause demons to tremble. I feel deliverance in here. I'm about to walk in such an anointing that my spirit is going to be anointed. If you hungry for his presence, if you want his glory, if you want God to restore your prayer life, jump on your feet and shout glory. Don't sit down. Now, I told you to go to Genesis 1, right? Go there. Now again, if a man is a prophet, he danced to the beat of a different drummer. He says things that don't make sense. When he says it, it looks like a lie until it comes to pass. Matter of fact, I want to give you a revelation today. And look at somebody say truth. Come on, say it for power. Say truth. Before time seems like a lie. Truth before time seems like a lie. Now remember, truth operates in eternity. Truth is not bound by time. Okay, what do you mean? Isaiah prophesies and says, in Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14, a virgin shall conceive a son. Okay. Now, they already think he's crazy because he walk around talking about a virgin going to have a baby. They say something wrong with that man. Then around the 22nd, 23rd chapter, God tells Isaiah, walk around the city naked for 2 years. I'm in the book, church, as a sign to the Egyptians. He was going to strip them naked. Now, they already think he crazy because he said a virgin going to have a baby. Now they really think he crazy because he walking around naked talking about God told them to do it. So at the time, what he said seemed like a lie. Because for years, that word never came to pass. But one day, time caught up with truth. Are you with that?
So when a prophet or a man of God speaks something over your life, when he says it, it seems like a lie. If I lay hands on you and prophesy and declare, thus saith the Lord, your son gonna be a preacher. But your son in jail right now. And I say, your son is a preacher. He's a man of God preaching all over the world. And you look at me and say, hey, you missed it, brother. My son in jail, he must have a jail ministry, but it sure ain't around the world. What I said seems like a lie. But sooner or later, time is going to catch up with the truth. If you're with me, say, I'm with you. So Genesis 1:26 says something real profound. And if you give me about 15 minutes, I'm going to get to my point. There's a glory going to hit this place tonight. Somebody shout, undeniable glory. So I'm going to speed through this quick. But Genesis 1:26 says something profound. And God said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. That's what your Bible say? Let them have what? Dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowls of the air, the cattle of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the face of the earth. That's what your Bible say? Yes. Okay. Genesis 1:26. Let us make man in our own image. That's verse 26. Verse 27 declares, so God created man in his own image. You got that? All right, look at me. God talking. God say, hey, let's make a man, and let's make him look like me. Verse 26. 27, after he says it, he does it. The man is created. Go to Genesis chapter 2. I'm going somewhere. Somebody in here, I promise you, after tonight, your steering wheel is going to turn into your altar. While you riding in your car, the Holy Ghost going to begin to visit you. Somebody, some of you going to try to go to bed and the Holy Ghost going to pull you to the side of your bedroom. Ain't nothing like trying to mind your own business and the Holy Ghost tell you, come spend time with me. That's some good stuff, ain't it? Oh, that's some good stuff. 1:26 say, let us make man. Verse 27, he created the man. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. Hold on. 26, let's make a man. 27, he created the man. Genesis 2 and 7. He forms a man. Hold on. 26, let's make a man. 27, he creates a man. The man now. Genesis 2 and 7, he forms a man. Now, some theologians suggest that chapter 2 is a overview or a slowing down of Genesis 1. But let me give you my view. If he said, let us make man in our own image, that means that whatever man he made in Genesis 1 had to look just like him. Well, what is God? See, you can't understand who that man is till you know who God is. What is God? St. John 4:24. God is a spirit. Y'all quiet. They that worship him must worship him in what? And in? Well, what is a spirit? What is a spirit? When we hear the word spirit, most of us think of castle with a friendly ghost. But let me help you understand what a spirit is. St. John 6:63 declares, it is the spirit that quickeneth and the flesh profiteth nothing. For the words that I speak unto you, they are what? Spirit and life. God is a spirit. A spirit is nothing but a word. What you mean is a word? John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was. That's all God is. He's a word. If God is a word, and I'm made in his image and likeness, guess what I am? A word. And if I'm a word, I need to be careful of the words I speak. Because Proverbs 18 declares, death and life is in the power of my tongue. You got me? Okay. What do you mean? You got to get this. Everything in this room right now is a word. You're sitting on a word right now. Pew. You're wearing a word. Clothes. You breathe a word. Air. Everything is a word. Well, hold on here. If you saying in Genesis 1, he made a word man, what is he doing in Genesis 2? He gives the word a body. You'll catch it when you get home. He forms a man. He takes that spirit and put it inside of a body, because spirits are illegal on earth if they don't have a body. Y'all should read your Bible sometimes. You know that, right? Spirits need a body. Genesis 1 is a spirit man. Genesis 2 is the flesh man. So that's spirit and body. But then he breathed into him the breath of life. And man became a what? Living soul. I read one translation. It said man came to be. That's so deep to me. That is so deep. He came to be. Because every commandment in the Bible God gave us is a be command. He didn't say do strong. He said. He didn't say do holy. He said. You're not called human doings. You're called human. Because you were created to be. But you're so busy trying to do. Oh, you'll catch that when you get home. That you can't be. But when you be what he called you to be, then you can do what he called you to do. I'm going somewhere. Now notice what man he gave dominion to. Genesis 1, let us make man our own image. Let them have dominion. Genesis 2, he forms a man, but don't give that man nothing. But the man in Genesis 1, he gave dominion. So notice what man he gave dominion to. He didn't give dominion to your flesh. He gave dominion to your spirit. Well, why are you trying to fight stuff in the flesh that can only be dealt with in the... Oh, y'all gonna catch it. For the weapons of our warfare are not... Tell somebody, this thing is spiritual. This thing, come on, you ain't say that right. Come on, tell them, this thing is spiritual. That demon coming against your marriage is spiritual. That demon coming against your ministry is spiritual. That sickness attacking your body, it's spiritual. And you sitting up trying to deal with something in the natural that could only be dealt with in the spirit. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness and high places, the rulers of darkness of this world. Slap your neighbor and say, this thing is spiritual. This thing that is happening in our country, I don't care who the president is, I don't care what party gets in power, this ain't no party problem, this is a sin problem. Proverbs 14:34 declares that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach unto any people. Until you deal with the spirit, that thing gonna keep coming.
coming back. And I need to help somebody in here, because you wonder why something keep happening in your life. You don't never deal with the spirit, you just deal with the person. So you get rid of the person and the spirit shows up in somebody else, because you don't deal with the spirit. But I've been sent by the Holy Ghost to get all the way to the root of that matter and command every demon torment your life. It got to go in the name of Jesus. Somebody shout, it gotta go. This thing is spiritual. Sit down. You got to recognize that when the enemy is after you, when he's trying to destroy you, the devil is not just trying to possess a person, but there are demons assigned to every region. You remember Mark, the 5th chapter, when the demon came out of the man, he said, I don't mind coming out, but don't make me leave the country. Don't make me leave the grave. See, there are demons assigned to certain cities. There's a demon of homosexuality assigned to Atlanta and San Francisco. There's a demon of murder in Chicago. There's a demon of lust and greed in Nevada. Are you hearing me? There are demons hanging over certain cities. That's why some of y'all ain't going through stuff until you move to a certain city, until you got in a certain neighborhood, until you got to a certain house, because there was a demon hanging over that region. And I don't care what you do, until you deal with that principality, it's going to keep coming against you. You got to stop coming to church and patty cake and God. You know what we need in church? We need people who don't want to preach but want to pray. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Everybody want to preach but don't nobody want to pray. Don't nobody want to come to church and get on your face. Let me tell you something. There are attacks that have come against this ministry. It wasn't natural, it was spiritual, because the man of God stood up and declared holiness and righteousness, and there were demons assigned. You're quiet in here. You don't you dare think that witches don't come in the service. You got witches. Matter of fact, you got some of them in here right now. But I break your power, kotorea, and declare no weapon, y'all ain't talking to me, formed against this house shall prosper. Shake somebody and say, the blood. Come on, tell somebody, it's spiritual, it's spiritual, it's spiritual. Yeah. Y'all sit down, I'm almost done. There's spirits that are assigned to regions. You got to deal with the spirit, because that's where your dominion is. That's where your authority is. That's why I feel sorry for people who don't believe in speaking in tongues as the spirit of God give evidence. Because the Bible declares that when you don't know what to pray, the spirit itself maketh intercession and groanings which cannot be uttered. There are times I don't know what to pray. I don't know the right words to say, but I know how to get on my knees and say, y'all ain't talking back to me in here. Shake your neighbor and say, don't you mess with me. I speak in tongues on you. Don't you mess with me. I go to praying, and when I pray, demons begin to tremble. When I pray, cancer dries up. Don't make me pray on you. This thing is spiritual. I'm almost done, y'all. It's spiritual. It's spiritual. Not only are demons after regions, after persons, but demons are after spirits, are after houses. When I say your house, I'm not talking about your address, but I'm talking about everything that came out of your loins. You know, the house of Carn, the house of Smith, the house of Jacob, the house of David, the house of Issachar. Am I making sense here? There are demons assigned to your house. What do you mean? You wonder why everybody in your family keep dealing with the same issue. Why this thing keep creeping up? Where is it coming from? Yeah, your daughter is unhappy. Now you unhappy. Your mama was unhappy. Your grandma unhappy. Y'all quiet. It's okay. But I'm going to get that devil up off of you tonight. You're sitting up wondering, that demon called divorce ran in your family. You wonder why you can't stay married. Ain't even nothing going on. But it's a spirit assigned to your house. You don't have money. Your mama never had money. There are demons assigned to the house. And until you deal with that spirit, it's going to keep on reoccurring in your life. But God told me, he said, son, when you get in here tonight, I want you to break every spirit that came down the bloodline that's been holding them back.
Sit down.
I said, Lord, what do you mean? I said, what do you mean? The Holy Ghost said to me, he said, son, you see it all through the Bible. I said, what you mean? You see it all through the Bible. He said, everybody loves to talk about Jacob and how Jacob was a trickster. And now he was a supplanter. He was a trickster. He was a supplanter. Yes, he was. Oh, he was that in every bit of it. And everybody loves to talk about Jacob. But I'm sick of y'all talking about Jacob and don't talk about his mama. Because he wasn't a trick. His mama was a trick too. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Because the Bible says she helped him trick. Y'all ain't talking to me. Not only was Jacob a trick, not only was the mama a trick, but he had an uncle named Laban who was a trick. Because his uncle told him, if you work for 7 years, I give you Rachel. Y'all quiet in here. But lied. So the mama's a trick. The dad, the uncle's a trick. But hold on. Hold on here. Where did he get this old lying, conniving spirit from? He got it from his daddy Isaac, who lied and said that his wife was his sister. But Isaac got it from Abraham, who said that his wife was his sister. Y'all quiet in here. This thing was in the bloodline, and it was never dealt with. But every demon in your bloodline that's been holding you back, it got to come out tonight. I'm not just talking about Jacob. I'm not just talking about him. How about David? David rejected by his father. Some suggest that he was rejected by his father because while the other boys was in the house, David was outside the house. Rejected by his father. Opens the door for a spirit of perversion to creep in his life. Now he's anointed, but he got a lust problem. Quiet. Anointed, but he got issues. Anointed, but there's a spirit in his life that he can't get under control. Quiet. David was so full of lust that the only way they knew he was dead was they sent a young girl in there. And when the young girl went into David's house and David didn't move, they said, the king is dead. I'm in the book, church. I ain't make it up. I'm in the book. David, rejected by his father. A spirit of lust creeps in his life. He's a man after God's own heart, but there's a war, there's a struggle going on in his members that he can't seem to get the power over because of this spirit in his life. No wonder why he has a son named Absalom who's treacherous and deceitful. Yeah. No wonder why he got another son named Amnon who rapes his daughter Tamar. No wonder why he got another son named Solomon with 700 wives and 300 concubines, dated all those strange women who turned his heart away from God because this spirit was in the bloodline and it was never dealt with. I say, what are you saying? He said, son, I don't want to just talk about David. I don't want to just talk about Isaac. I don't want to just talk about Jacob. He said, but tell them tonight, it's time for you to look at your house. It's time for you to look at that spirit. Your daughter fighting stuff at 15 that you didn't deal with
quit till you was 28. You want to know why? Because that demon done got greedy. That demon see you in the church. That demon see you want to be set free. So that devil saying, I'm going to do whatever I can to this trauma. I don't want them to get set free. That's why you got to stop coming to church when you get ready. And you got to be in the house of God, because the house of God is your only place of safety. But I need you to shake your neighbor one more time. And I want you to shake them real hard. And I don't want you to play with it. Come on, shake them, shake them, shake them, shake them. And say, neighbor, 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 every demon in your family, every stronghold on your daddy's side, every demon on your mother's side, the devil gonna let you go tonight. You're not gonna deal with your daddy demons. You're not gonna deal with your mama's strongholds. God's gonna set you free from every... Come on, slap somebody. Say, it gotta go tonight. It gotta go. Yay, baby, 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 shake. I said, slap somebody real hard and tell them it gotta go tonight. Yeah. Every demon, every stronghold, every spirit attached to my family, it gotta go tonight. I want the devil to know that whatever he planned to do to your life, it's been canceled. There's a demon that's been assigned to your life that don't plan on hitting you till you're 30. That don't hit you till you're 35. But the devil is a liar. I command every demon that's waiting to destroy you. I plead the blood over every stronghold and declare the devil gotta let you go. Somebody scream. Bother nobody. Do whatever you believe Lord told you to do. But he was preaching this grace message, and he got on television, and he said, you ain't got to pray no more. He said, Jesus prayed for you. I said, the devil is a liar. Luke 18 declares, men ought always to pray and to faint not. 1 Thessalonians 5 declares, pray without ceasing. He didn't say if you pray, he said, but when you pray. You know what's wrong with us? You want to know why you got mess in your life? Because you don't pray. He said, pray lest you enter into temptation. I can tell people who spend time with God. I can tell in your life. I can tell the way you live. Because when you spend time with him and you have fellowship with him and you commune with him, your desire is to always do those things that please the Father. But some of you in here today, you don't pray. You don't fast. God spoke to me the other day. He said, son, if Jesus had to pray, who was perfect, who did no sin, who never did no evil, if he had to pray, how much more you got to pray? You want to know why I pray? I was talking to somebody and they say, you act like you holy, you praying all time like you holy. I said, I'm not praying because I'm holy. I'm praying because I got stuff in my life that I need God to break up off of me. I'm praying because I got demons on my back. I'm praying because there's a war going on in my members. When I would do good, evil is always present. I'm praying because I got mess in my life, that if I don't pray, I got demons from my daddy and demons from my grandfather, generational curses that the devil wants to bring upon my life. But if I pray, I can beat the devil. I got to pray. Shake your neighbor and say, I gotta pray. Shake somebody real hard. Come on, shake them real. Come on, don't play with it. Shake them. Shake them. I don't care if they get mad at you. Shake them anyway and tell them it's praying time. It's praying time. It's time to turn off the TV. It's time to turn off your phone. And it's time to seek God like you never saw him before. Missouri ain't seen nothing. New York City ain't seen nothing. I don't care what nobody say. It's the wrath of God coming upon the children of disobedience. But if my people, which are called by my name, humble yourself, pray, seek my face, and turn from your wicked ways, I need you to run to three people and tell them it's praying time. for you to pray. You got to pray, because the devil is after your children. You got to pray, because there are demons after your family. You got to pray, because there's spirits that's been assigned to your house. And unless you pray, you can't keep the devil back. You got to pray, because there are demons assigned to your ministry. Let me tell you something. If you can't find nothing else to pray for, every morning I wake up, I rebuke the wandering of my mind. I pray that my mind don't leave me. Come on, don't act like your mind don't walk away from you. You can run down the street and forget where you're going. You can pick up the phone and forget who you're about to call. But Isaiah 26 said, I'll keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stayed on me. I've not given you a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. I got to pray. I got to pray so that I don't enter into temptation. I got to pray because there's a war going on in my members. I got to seek the face of God, because I told God the only way I'm gonna be like you is I got to spend time with you. I got to have fellowship. I got to have communion. Some of you in here, you wonder why you backbiting and bitter. You wonder why. You want to know why? Because you don't pray. He said, pray lest you enter into temptation. See, prayer is intimacy with God. But there's a law in the spirit that if you don't talk to God, you automatically begin to talk to the devil. So the reason you bitter, and the reason you backbiter, and the reason you full of malice, is because you've been talking to the devil. And that's what the devil is. But God's getting ready to raise up a people that are saying, listen here, I'll cut off whoever I got to cut off. I'll let go whoever I got to let go. But the next time you see me, I'm about to walk in a realm with God I never walked in. I'm about to get so full of power that when I walk in a room, my shadow is going to cause demons to tremble. I feel deliverance in here. I'm about to walk in such an anointing that my spit is going to be anointed. If you hungry for his presence, if you want his glory, if you want God to restore your prayer life, jump on your feet and shout glory.
Don't sit down. Now, I told you to go to Genesis 1, right? Go there. Now again, if a man is a prophet, he danced to the beat of a different drummer. He says things that don't make sense. When he says it, it looks like a lie until it comes to pass. Matter of fact, I want to give you a revelation today. And look at somebody, say truth. Come on, say it for power. Say truth. Before time seems like a lie. Truth before time seems like a lie. Now remember, truth operates in eternity. Truth is not bound by time. Okay, what do you mean? Isaiah prophesies and says, in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, a virgin shall conceive a son. Okay. Now, they already think he's crazy, because he walk around talking about a virgin going to have a baby. They say something wrong with that man. Then around the 22nd, 23rd chapter, God tells Isaiah, walk around the city naked for 2 years. I'm in the book, church, as a sign to the Egyptians. He was going to strip them naked. Now, they already think he crazy because he said a virgin going to have a baby. Now they really think he crazy because he walking around naked talking about God told them to do it. So at the time, what he said seemed like a lie. Because for years, that word never came to pass. But one day, time caught up with truth.
Are you with that?
So,
in the presence of the Lord, quickly, let's go to Genesis chapter 1, if you will. I was in the back, and the Lord just started showing me stuff. And make sure your cell phone on tonight, because I might call some of y'all. I'm serious. I was in the back, and I told them, I said, y'all have just seen a number come before me. And so just keep your phone on, but, you know, keep it on vibrate. I might call you and tell you what the Lord told me to tell you. All right? Now look at somebody and say, God is up to something. I want you to hear me, and I want you to hear me good tonight, because as I told you, that if a man is truly a prophet, if he really carries that mantle upon his life and he's really a prophet, and you got to remember something now, just because you have the gift of prophecy don't mean you're a prophet. Just because you prophesy don't mean you're a prophet. There were three different realms of the prophetic. You have the spirit of prophecy, you have the gift of prophecy, and you have the office of the prophet. Okay, the gift of prophecy is a gift that you're born with. Remember, God told Paul told Timothy, stir up the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by the laying on of hands. But if you pay attention, you notice that that gift was not only in him, it was also in his mother. Y'all remember, right? Yeah, I believe he had a mother named Eunice and a grandmother named Lois. So that gift came down the bloodline. Say amen. Amen. So you have the gift of prophecy, but then you have the spirit of prophecy. But because there's a prophetic anointing on my life and I'm ministering here tonight, the power of God can begin to move in the service and the atmosphere can become conducive for anything to take place. And the spirit of prophecy will come in the room and you will begin to prophesy just like King Saul prophesied when he got around the prophetic. But just because you prophesy don't mean you're a prophet. The office of the prophet is totally different. Now remember, Ephesians 4 and 11 declares he gave some apostles. You did hear some, right? So that means everybody saying they one can't be one. Y'all quiet. Y'all mad at me. What's wrong? I'm trying to help you tonight. Okay. He gave some. Somebody shout some. All right, now some. Now, the apostle of the church is the thumb of the church. You understand? The thumb can operate, or your thumb is your only finger that can touch every finger on your hand. So the apostle is the governor of the church. He brings order. He brings structure. He brings foundation. An apostle is a builder. He can't stay in one place. The apostle, the prophet, and the evangelist are traveling gifts. But the pastor and the teacher are stationary gifts. If a man is an apostle, he dances to the beat of a different drum. He's different. He's not like everybody else. I'm very disappointed with people who are calling themselves apostles now, but they have no power. They have no deliverance. The Bible declares that I have tried them who say that they are apostles and have found them to be liars. If you are an apostle, you have to operate in the apostolic anointing. You have to preach what the apostles preach, and your testimony have to be that you have seen the Lord. Y'all quiet in here. If you've not had a visitation from the Lord Jesus Christ, you cannot be an apostle. We see every apostle in the Bible who walk with Jesus, talk with Jesus, except for one named Paul. The Bible declares he was born out of due season. He didn't have the opportunity to walk with Jesus like the other apostles, but on the road to Damascus, a light shined out of heaven and said, Saul, Saul, why are y'all with me here? So he gave some apostles. Somebody shout, some. Okay, but then he gave some prophets. Now, the prophet is the index finger of the church. He comes to point to you, get in your face, tell you that God ain't gonna give you a new house until you stop shacking in the house you got. You're quiet, yeah. That's what the prophet comes to. Why y'all ain't shouting no more? What's wrong with you? Yeah, the prophet comes to tell you, like Isaiah went to Hezekiah and said, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live. I am very disappointed with these jellyback prophets who've had an opportunity to talk to the president, and they get in the White House and get up there and compromise because they want doors open. I told somebody the other day, they came to me the other day, and they say, Prophet Carn, if you keep on preaching like that, they're going to close their doors on you. I got discouraged for about 3 seconds, and then I heard the Holy Ghost say, I am the door. Y'all ain't talking back to me here. I don't care what door you close. If God open it, you can't close it. Y'all ain't talking back to me. You can shut the door of your church, and I'll set up a tent next door. I'm ready for a good old revival meeting. Somebody say hallelujah. I'm very disappointed. Y'all sit down with prophets who've had the opportunity to stand and talk to presidents, and they get there and compromise, all because they want to be somebody. They want to be recognized. They want to be seen. You got to understand that if a man is going to be a prophet, he has to be willing to be different. He can't be concerned about people liking him, fitting in a circle. As a matter of fact, if you're a prophet, you don't hang with everybody. You got to walk by yourself. You're going to be misunderstood. You're going to be despised and rejected. Don't nobody want to hear you when you telling them to come out of their sin and come out of their mess. God is mad with America. You sitting up here telling some God is going to bless a nation when he said if a man lay with another man, it's an abomination. And we trying to make right what God said is wrong. The Bible declares that judgment shall begin in the house of the Lord. But we got too many preachers who won't preach on homosexuality because it's in the praise team, because it's in the choir. But God's getting ready to raise up some real prophets who gonna call it like it is, that'll cry loud and a spare none. I need somebody to jump on your feet and shout glory. Be seated. He gave some apostles, some prophets. God has nothing to say to America but 2 Chronicles 7:14. That's all he's saying. If my people, yeah. That's all God is saying. That's what God is saying to this backslidden church. That's what God is saying to this church that got money but don't have no power. To this church that drive nice cars but no power, no deliverance. If you had as much power as you had money, think about how many people would be healed. Think about how many folk could be set free. God's calling this church back to a place of repentance. If my people, he wasn't talking to the drug dealer, he wasn't talking to the prostitute, but he was talking to the apostle, he was talking to the prophet, he was talking to the evangelist. He said, my people, which are called by my name, you got to humble yourself. Look at you arrogant preachers. You're arrogant, you're proud as a peacock. Can't nobody tell you nothing. God's getting ready to break these preachers. He gonna bring you back to your knees. God said, I hate arrogance. God's getting ready to humble you. That's why I'm telling God, whatever's in my life that ain't right, get it out of me. I don't want to preach to others and be a castaway. I don't want to come to church and die and go to hell. I want to be holy. I want to be right. Jump on your feet and shout hallelujah. You gotta humble yourself. Look at somebody shout, humble yourself. Why y'all ain't shouting? Come on. Look at somebody say, humble yourself. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. That old spirit of pride. It's a sneaky spirit. It's a conniving spirit. Pride. Proverbs 6:16 declares, 16 doth the Lord hate. 7 are an abomination. He said he hates a proud look that just killed 75% of all preachers. You come to church and look proud. You don't shout till you got the mic. You don't praise God till you got got the mic. I'm sick of you preachers that don't praise God unless you got the mic. When is the last time your church seen you dance? When is the last time your church seen you praise God? This old spirit of arrogance that is creeping across the body of Christ. He hates a proud look. God spoke to me one day. He said, son, pride is like a stealth jet. I say, what do you mean? He said, it's like a stealth jet. Well, I'm a church boy. I don't know what no stealth jet is. It's a military term. It's a warfare term that if they get ready to come in, if they go stealth, that means it can't be detected by the radar. That's what pride does. It sneaks in your life and you don't even recognize it's there. Pride is that spirit that got you where can't nobody tell you nothing. Pride is that spirit that got you where you can't submit to authority. Pride is that spirit where you sitting up here getting mad. Who we talking to? I'm talking to you with your proud self. Pride is that spirit that got you when somebody tell you something, you catching an attitude. Ain't no need in getting an attitude. If you're a real child of God, you don't get mad when you hear a word like this. You go to searching your heart. You're going to say, God, get pride out of me. Get this mess out of me. There was a man in the Bible by the name of Lucifer. You remember him. God told me, he said, pride is the only spirit that can stand in my presence. We saw it happen in Lucifer. He stood right there in the presence of God. Pride will let you preach. Pride will let you prophesy. Pride will let you sing on the praise team. Pride will let you sing in the choir. That's what pride will do. And some of you don't recognize that pride is that spirit that got you that you can't even get up. You won't even pray. You don't even seek God. You don't call on him. You want to know why? Because you think you don't need God. Some of you in here, when is the last time you got on your face and got on the altar and told God to make you over again? Pride is that spirit that won't let you pray. But there's about 500 people in here today that are saying, man of God, I hear God, and whatever's in me that ain't like God, I gotta get it out of me tonight. Cause God resists the proud, but he give grace to the humble. Shake three people and say, humble yourself, humble yourself, humble yourself. This ain't my message. Sit down. My people, call by my name. Slap somebody and say, humble yourself. You ain't say that with power, but come on, say, humble yourself. Humble yourself. That's what God is saying to America. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. Proverbs 8:13 say, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogance. Humble yourself. Preachers, humble yourself. Huh? Act like you can't open the door for yourself. Why y'all ain't shout no more? Humble yourself. Then he said, when you get done humbling yourself, I need you to get a prayer life. The sad thing about church, we're so good at doing church. And most of us in here today, you don't have to tell me, I just know. Most of us in here tonight didn't pray for 1 hour. And he said to the disciples, could not you wait with me but for 1 hour? But we sit home and watch TV. Y'all quiet. We stay on social media, Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, and the enemy is slowly pulling us away from the presence of God. Lord said to me one time, he said, son, the enemy is doing the church. You may have heard me say it before, like an amphibian. I said, Lord, what in the world is that? You know, a frog is an amphibian. It can adjust to any temperature. I said, okay, what that mean? He said, if you want to cook a frog, if you pull him in hot boiling water, he'll jump out. But if you put him in the water cold and slowly turn up the heat, because he can adjust to the temperature, he's being cooked and he don't know it. I said, well, what that got to do with us? He said, that's what the devil did to you. Things that used to bother you don't bother you no more. When you first got saved, if it was too much cussing, you turn it off. Oh, y'all quiet in here, yeah. You turn on the TV, they were cussing too much, you turn it off. If it was too much flesh, you turn it off. If you was in a room with people that were sitting up gossiping and backbiting, you get up out of the room. But now, you sit in there, talk with them, watch anything on television, they use profanity and curse, it don't bother you no more, because slowly, you're becoming numb to what you used to hate. And it's because you've lost your prayer life. You've lost your dedication. I heard a preacher on television just the other day. He said he was preaching this grace message. You know, they preaching this big grace message now. And I ain't trying to know when a prophet or a man of God speaks something over your life. When he says it, it seems like a lie. I lay hands on you and prophesy and declare, thus says the Lord, your son gonna be a preacher. But your son in jail right now. And I say, your son is a preacher. He's a man of God preaching all over the world. And you look at me and say, hey, you missed it, brother. My son in jail, he must have a jail ministry, but it sure ain't around the world. What I said seems like a lie. But sooner or later, time is going to catch up with the truth. If you're with me, say, I'm with you.
So Genesis 1:26 says something real profound. And if you give me about 15 minutes, I'm going to get to my point. There's a glory going to hit this place tonight.
Somebody shout, undeniable glory.
So I'm going to speed through this quick. But Genesis 1:26 says something profound. And God said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. That's what your Bible say? Yes. Let them have what? Dominion. Over the fish of the sea, the fowls of the air, the cattle of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the face of the earth. That's what your Bible say?
Yes.
Okay. Genesis 1:26, let us make man in our own image. That's verse 26. Verse 27 declares, so God created man in his own image. You got that? All right, look at me. God talking. God say, hey, let's make a man. And let's make him look like me. Verse 26. 27, after he says it, he does it. The man is created. Go to Genesis chapter 2. I'm going somewhere. Somebody in here, I promise you, after tonight, your steering wheel is going to turn into your altar.
While you riding in your car, the Holy Ghost going to begin to visit you. Somebody, Bahashatalamahosaya. Some of you are going to try to go to bed and the Holy Ghost going to pull you to the side of your bedroom.
Ain't nothing like trying to mind your own business and the Holy Ghost tell you, come spend time with me.
That's some good stuff, ain't it? Oh, that's some good stuff.
1:26 say, let us make man. Verse 27, he created the man. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. Hold on. 26, let's make a man. 27, he created the man. Genesis 2 and 7, he forms a man. Hold on. 26, let's make a man. 27, he creates a man. The man now. Genesis 2 and 7, he forms a man. Now, some theologians suggest that chapter 2 is an overview or a slowing down of Genesis 1. But let me give you my view. If he said, let us make man in our own image, that means that whatever man he made in Genesis 1 had to look just like him. Well, what is God? See, you can't understand who that man is till you know who God is. What is God? St. John 4:24. God is a spirit. Y'all quiet. They that worship him must worship him in what? Spirit. And in? Well, what is a spirit? What is a spirit? When we hear the word spirit, most of us think of Casper, the friendly ghost. But let me help you understand what a spirit is. St. John 6:63 declares, it is the spirit that quickeneth and the flesh profiteth nothing. For the words that I speak unto you, they are what? Spirit and life. God is a spirit. A spirit is nothing but a word. What you mean is a word. John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was. That's all God is. He's a word. If God is a word, and I'm made in his image and likeness, guess what I am? A word. And if I'm a word, I need to be careful of the words I speak. Because Proverbs 18 declares, death and life is in the power of my tongue. You got me? Okay, okay. What do you mean? You got to get this. Everything in this room right now is a word. You're sitting on a word right now. Pew. You're wearing a word. Clothes. You breathe a word. Air. Everything is a word. Well, hold on here. If you saying in Genesis 1, he made a word man, what is he doing in Genesis 2? He gives the word a body. You'll catch it when you get home. He forms a man. He takes that spirit and put it inside of a body, because spirits are illegal on earth if they don't have a body. Y'all should read your Bible sometimes. You know that, right? Spirits need a body. Genesis 1 is a spirit man. Genesis 2 is the flesh man. So there's spirit and body, but then he breathe into him the breath of life, and man became a what? Living soul. I read one translation. It said, man came to be. That's so deep to me. That is so deep. He came to be. Because every commandment in the Bible God gave us is a be command. He didn't say do strong. He said. Be strong. He didn't say do holy. He said. Holy. You're not called human doings. You're called human. Because you were created to be. But you so busy trying to do. Oh, you'll catch that when you get home. That you can't be. But when you be what he called you to be, then you can do what he called you to do. I'm going somewhere. Now notice what man he gave dominion to. Genesis 1,
Let us make man our own image. Let them have dominion. Genesis 2, he forms a man, but don't give that man nothing. But the man in Genesis 1, he gave dominion. So notice what man he gave dominion to. He didn't give dominion to your flesh. He gave dominion to your spirit. Well, why are you trying to fight stuff in the flesh that can only be dealt with in the... Oh, y'all gonna catch it. For the weapons of our warfare are not... Tell somebody, this thing is spiritual. This thing, come on, you ain't say that right. Come on, tell them, this thing is spiritual. That demon coming against your marriage is spiritual. That demon coming against your ministry is spiritual. That sickness attacking your body, it's spiritual. And you sitting up trying to deal with something in the natural that could only be dealt with in the spirit. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness and high places, the rulers of darkness of this world. Slap your neighbor and say, this thing is spiritual. This thing that is happening in our country, I don't care who the president is, I don't care what party gets in power, this ain't no party problem, this is a sin problem. Proverbs 14:34 declares that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach unto any people. Until you deal with the spirit, that thing gonna keep coming back. And I need to help somebody in here, because you wonder why something keep happening in your life. You don't never deal with the spirit, you just deal with the person. So you get rid of the person and the spirit shows up in somebody else, because you don't deal with the spirit. But I've been sent by the Holy Ghost to get all the way to the root of that matter and command every demon torment your life, it got to go in the name of Jesus. Somebody shout, it gotta go. This thing is spiritual. Sit down. You gotta recognize that when the enemy is after you, when he's trying to destroy you, the devil is not just trying to possess a person, but there are demons assigned to every region. You remember Mark, the 5th chapter, when the demon came out of the man, he said, I don't mind coming out, but don't make me leave the country. Don't make me leave the grave. See, there are demons assigned to certain cities. There's a demon of homosexuality assigned to Atlanta and San Francisco. There's a demon of murder in Chicago. There's a demon of lust and greed in Nevada. Are you hearing me? There are demons hanging over certain cities. That's why some of y'all ain't going through stuff until you move to a certain city, until you got in a certain neighborhood, until you got to a certain house, because there was a demon hanging over that region. And I don't care what you do, until you deal with that principality, it's going to keep coming against you. You got to stop coming to church and patty cake and God. You know what we need in church? We need people who don't want to preach but want to pray. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Everybody want to preach but don't nobody want to pray. Don't nobody want to come to church and get on your face. Let me tell you something. There are attacks that have come against this ministry. It wasn't natural. It was spiritual, because the man of God stood up and declared holiness and righteousness, and there were demons assigned. Y'all quiet in here. Don't you dare think that witches don't come in the service. You got witches. Matter of fact, you got some of them in here right now. But I break your power, kotorea, and declare no weapon. Y'all ain't talking to me. Formed against this house shall prosper. Shake somebody and say the blood. Come on, tell somebody, it's spiritual, it's spiritual, it's spiritual. Yeah. Y'all sit down, I'm almost done. There's spirits that are assigned to regions. You got to deal with the spirit, because that's where your dominion is. That's where your authority is. That's why I feel sorry for people who don't believe in speaking in tongues as the spirit of God give evidence. Because the Bible declares that when you don't know what to pray, the spirit itself maketh intercession and groanings which cannot be uttered. There are times I don't know what to pray. I don't know the right words to say, but I know how to get on my knees and say, y'all ain't talking back to me in here. Shake your neighbor and say, don't you mess with me. I'll speak in tongues on you. Don't you mess with me. I'll go to praying, and when I pray, demons begin to tremble. When I pray, cancer dries up. Don't make me pray on you. This thing is spiritual. I'm almost done, y'all. It's spiritual. It's spiritual. Not only are demons after regions, after persons, but demons are after spirits, are after houses. When I say your house, I'm not talking about your address, but I'm talking about everything that came out of your loins. You know, the house of Carn, the house of Smith, the house of Jacob, the house of David, the house of Issachar. Are you making, am I making sense here? There are demons assigned to your house. What do you mean? You wonder why everybody in your family keep dealing with the same issue. Why this thing keep creeping up? Where is it coming from? Yeah, your daughter is unhappy. Now you unhappy. Your mama was unhappy. Your grandma unhappy. Y'all quiet. It's okay. But I'm going to get that devil up off of you tonight. You're sitting up wondering, that demon called divorce ran in your family. You wonder why you can't stay married. Ain't even nothing going on. But it's a spirit assigned to your house. You don't have money. Your mama never had money. There are demons assigned to the house. And until you deal with that spirit, it's going to keep on reoccurring in your life. But God told me, he said, son, when you get in here tonight, I want you to break every spirit that came down the bloodline that's been holding them back.
So now,
I said, Lord, what do you mean?
Say, what do you mean?
The Holy Ghost said to me, he said, son, you see it all through the Bible. I say, what you mean? You see it all through the Bible. He said, everybody loves to talk about Jacob and how Jacob was a trickster. And now he was a supplanter. He was a trickster. He was a supplanter. Yes, he was. Oh, he was that in every bit of it. And everybody loves to talk about Jacob. But I'm sick of y'all talking about Jacob and don't talk about his mama. Because he wasn't a trick. His mama was a trick too. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Because the Bible says she helped him trick. Y'all ain't talking to me. Not only was Jacob a trick, not only was the mama a trick, but he had an uncle named Laban who was a trick.